Hello, welcome to another Bug Bounty Reports Explained video. Today I will show you how Ryan Pickren found a chain of 0 days that led to universal cross-site scripting in Safari, which allowed hacking any website. Literally any website, Facebook, Gmail, PayPal or your crypto wallet, whatever. He got a huge bounty of $100,500 for it. Link to the original well-written blog post is in the description. Enjoy! This episode is sponsored by Blaze Information Security. It's a team of experienced hackers who specialize in penetration testing and application security services. They can offer your company a wide range of services, pen tests, red teams, threat modeling, and even the whole assessment of your remote work infrastructure. They also have a special package for startups. If you want to know more, check out blazeinfosec.com. And I know the owner. He was hacking before I was even born, so he knows his business. Web archive files are used to save whole websites, HTML, CSS, JS and images, everything in a single file. It's an XML-based format and it looks like this. The base64 encoded content is here, and here is the origin. Yes, you heard me right, there is an origin specified. Back in 2013, if you could control the contents of this file, you could just put an arbitrary origin, encode the XSS payload, and you would be able to execute the code on any domain and access any domain's cookies. Such an attack is called universal XSS. It's not a bug in a particular website, but in the browser, which makes it insanely powerful. The attacker can steal data from every website that you use, so the potential impact is huge. According to Google, almost as valuable as an RCE. So, back in 2013, if you could force the victim into downloading and opening such a file, you could perform this attack. But it's not how it works in 2022, with more security mechanisms in Safari and macOS. But let's try to bypass them. The attack has to start with phishing the victim into visiting our website. It should not be a big problem, but every single user interaction makes the attack less and less likely. The first problem that we encounter from here is the prompt about downloading a file, because the first time you download a file from any domain, Safari will ask you for the permission. It would look quite bad with the attacker domain. The same goes for opening applications with custom URL schemes. If you open, let's say, a Discord URL, it will try to use the custom URL scheme. Safari will then ask you for permission to open the desktop Discord application. But it's not for every single URL scheme. There's an allow list of trusted Apple applications that don't have to ask for the permission. Among others, you can use iCloud-sharing, which is open by ShareBear application, for, as the name suggests, sharing files over iCloud. It's much helpful because, apart from being whitelisted by Safari, it's also a perfect vector for delivering the web archive file to the victim. That's great. But there is a catch. First time opening a file, the victim has to confirm it. This is not an ideal attack scenario, but also not the end of the world. Importantly, after one confirmation of opening the file, the attacker can modify the file completely, and the victim won't have to reconfirm opening it. After the modifications, ShareBear will automatically download the new version of the file to victim's machine. Okay, so we have delivering the file to the victim taken care of, and now we can run it. Unless we can't, because Gatekeeper blocks it. Because by default, any downloaded file on macOS is quarantined. Gatekeeper prevents executing quarantined files like shell scripts and web archives. Yes, they also thought about web archives and they explicitly mentioned them in the documentation. So when Safari tries to open a file, it goes through the gatekeeper, and in this case, web archives get blocked. We could bypass that if we would find a vector where Safari opens a file without asking gatekeeper. And after a bit of research, Ryan found out that Windows URL files do exactly that. It's a format that specifies things like the URL of the shortcut, the icon, and so on. You can just make a desktop shortcut to a website. You can also use a file protocol. And turns out that if you open this shortcut file with path to web archive, instead of opening the web archive directly, it bypasses the gatekeeper. And one last piece of the puzzle is the path of the downloaded web archive file. Normally, it will be inside the user directory, so we would need to know the macOS username. It's okay when you target a specific victim, but hard to predict with an attack on a big scale. To solve this problem, you can use a DMG file. It's a disk image format that contains an archive with another files inside. The reason why it solves the problem is that it's mounted into volumes directory, which means we don't need to know the username to predict its location. So what is it finally? A web archive, a DMG, a URL file? I know that you are confused, so let's go through the whole exploit. First, you have to trick the victim into visiting our website. This website contains such JavaScript code. It contains a link to a harmless image shared over iCloud. The user has to confirm the prompt about opening a file. This is the last piece of user interaction that we need. Now you have to modify contents of the image to a DMG file, which contains the web archive inside. In the real attack scenario, you would probably need some scripts to do this automatically. Now Safari launches this file and the disk image is mounted into volumes directory. The web archive is available under this path. Now you modify contents of the file again. Importantly, the disk image is already mounted in volumes directory, and it's not removed from there or modified, even though you make a modification on your iCloud account. This time, you turn this file into the URL format, pointing to the web archive, which is inside volumes directory. Inside the web archive file, there is your arbitrary JavaScript code and arbitrary domain which you'd like to attack. After the web archive file is launched in Safari, your code gets executed on whichever domain you chose. With universal cross-site scripting, you can do whatever the user can do in their browser. Attack PayPal and transfer funds to you. Attack Gmail and steal or send emails as the victim. You can attack a website like Zoom or FaceTime, which is likely to have a permission to the camera, and you can see what the victim is doing. And many, many more. The reward for this bug was $100,500 and there were 2 CVEs issued. As for the fix, the ShareBear application now only reveals a file instead of launching it directly, and WebKit now won't open any quarantined files, even via Windows shortcuts. If you've learned anything new from this video, leave a like and subscribe to the channel. If you want to see other bug bounty reports from Apple, check out this playlist on your right. You can find there a $28,000 either in Apple shortcuts or $50,000 RCE. But for now, thank you for watching and goodbye.